We want this to be repeated. Now, of course, one way to do it is to choose this to be zero. Let me say that. Sorry. But we want this under Lorentz transformations. Sorry. So we've got a f of x, x mu. Now let's look at an infinitesimal Lorentz transformation. Okay. So let's delta x mu be the change in x mu under the infinitesimal Lorentz transformation. Okay. So how does this object change? Yeah, we've already put translational invariance by saying that it's functional mu x mu. Okay. So then this is del f by del x mu dot times delta x mu dot. Okay, because the dot lambda has nothing to do with the dot, the dot just goes. Okay, so in that situation, this is the change in the action. Now, of course, one thing that we could do is to make f Lorentz invariant. In which case, this thing is zero. That's what we did last time. But suppose you want to allow non-zero values in this. Okay? What you demand is that this object here is a total derivative. Now, the important thing is that this object here is either a constant or a function of x mu dot. I mean, f is a function of x mu dot. So del f by l, del x mu dot is a function of x mu dot. Could happen to be the constant function. Now, if it happens to be constant, then this thing is a total error. There is no other choice that makes it a total error. Because, you see, as you were saying, f of x times x dot is a total error. That's the total derivative of the integral of f. But there's no function of x dot. There's no nominative function of x dot for arbitrary x dot. Times x dot, that's a total error. X dot squared is not a total error. X dot cube is not good. Okay, so we take x by this. There's no function for this.
But initially it said we are taking it to be translation. If it is not an with some small translation, it becomes it changes by some time derivative.
Yeah, we have to recur. But what I was trying now was the analog of what we did for Galilean. You remember that when we were trying to study an action that was invariant under Galilean boosts, the Lagrangian itself was translationally invariant, but it wasn't invariant under boosts. It was invariant only under Taylor. So Harshan's worry was that maybe there would be something analogous there. Let's first check that. Okay? So what do we conclude from it? We conclude that this is a total derivative only if f dot is a constant. If del f by del x mu dot is a constant. In which case, the thing that we're adding to the action is linear x mu dot. In which case the addition to the action is itself a total derivative. So it's a trivial addition. So basically there are no possibilities like that for Lorentz invariants. Okay? Now we could recurse further to implement translational invariants also. I would have to think through it. Okay. Sorry. So, fine. So let's continue. Let me review what we talked. Oh, yes, somebody needs to put that on.
Yeah.
Okay. So let me remind you what we discussed last class. In the last class, we started our discussion.
Written on the screen.
It's on, right?
Yeah, I should say REC.
It was recording.
It's recording. It's recording.
Okay, so in the last class we discussed that we wanted to find, we had two parallel motivational streams in our discussion in the last class. The first one was a slight discomfort with this.
Can you just repeat the argument?
Okay, so the question that was being asked was the following. Was, could you have a Lagrangian that is itself not Lorentz invariant, but whose variation under Lorentz transformations is a total derivative? Okay. So we were looking for a Lagrangian which was a function of x mu dot something. We're building in translation invariance into this Lagrangian. Okay? So we're looking at the Lagrangian, so I'll just give you a right? Suppose the Lagrangian is some f of x mu dot. D. it's the variation of this Lagrangian under a Lorentz transformation to be a total layer. Then we consider an infinitesimal Lorentz transformation. And let the variation of x mu under a Lorentz transformation, any particular Lorentz transformation, be delta x mu. Okay? This is some matrix times x mu, as we know, but I don't care what it is. It won't matter. Under such a Lorentz transformation, the variation of x mu dot, delta of x mu dot, is simply delta x mu, the whole thing dot. Because Lorentz transformations have nothing to do with this lambda value. Okay, so now let's look at how this Lagrangian here varies under a Lorentz transformation. Okay, the change in the Lagrangian is what? It's the change in f. So it's delta f by delta x mu dot times the change in x mu, which is delta x mu, the moving dot. Now the important point is delta x mu dot is linear in x mu dot sense. So Lorentz transformation is this linear transformation. Okay. So this with some matrix structure is some m mu nu x mu. Well, this m is the matrix for Lorentz transformation. Okay, now you see, what we want is that this object here is a total derivative. Now one option is that it's zero. Okay, so that the change in f under a Lorentz transformation is zero. That's the option that we implemented in the last class. Okay, but we're studying options in which this is not the case. But this whole thing doesn't vanish. Now we have two cases. One case is that this object here, which is some function of x mu dot, is a constant function. In this case, this is a constant matrix times total derivative, and therefore is a total derivative. Okay? So the variation of this action under a Lorentz transformation is a total derivative. This is the kind of thing that we were interested in. However, this unfortunately is trivial, because in this case, f was itself a linear function of x mu dot. So the change in the Lagrangian itself was a total derivative. Okay? So when you change a Lagrangian by a total derivative, you're not changing the equation of the motion by at all. So this is a trivial option. Basically, no other option gives you a total derivative. Okay? What?
How is f a linear function?
If its variation with respect to x mu dot is a constant, then it's linear in x mu.
So what is the expression for that?
A is a constant.
I mean, what is the actual expression? The actual expression isn't it the inner part of x mu dot x mu dot.
That expression gives zero from this thing. We're looking at things where the variation under Lorentz transformation is not zero. So the answer is something invariant under Lorentz transformations plus something that has to be of this form. But it's a total derivative. So that rule, okay. Anything else, anything here that is nonlinear in x mu dots will be a nonlinear function of x mu dots. And that is never a total derivative for arbitrary x mu. For instance, x dot squared is not a total derivative. X dot y dot is not a total derivative for arbitrary functions x mu.
So just one more thing. In the correspondence limit we take, like the Lagrangian for additivity to possible. So this is not preserved.
What is not preserved?
The fact that Galilean action for classical particle is invariant under Galilean.
You see, what's good? So that's a good question. And the point there is that what was a variable is changing. You see, x0 dot was also taken to be a variable in this lecture. Okay? So a transformation that in xi, which was proportional to x0, in this action is treated as linear in the fields of action. In the other action, would not be treated as linear in the fields of the action because x0 is time. Okay? That gives the non-homogeneous part. And that's the issue there. Okay? So that's how this correspondence goes. The difference once again is that Lorentz transformations are linear in fields, whereas Galilean boosts are not linear in fields. Because the fields are x size, and other Galilean boost, xi goes to xi minus bt, but t is not a field, so kind of integral. Okay, that was the reason. Okay, other questions about this? Okay. So just to remind you what we discussed in the last class. If it is what?
If it differs, it should differ in a total derivative.
Yes, any Lagrangian that generates equations of motion that are Lorentz invariant should have the following property. Should have the property that the variation of the action under a Lorentz transformation is zero. And therefore the variation of the Lagrangian under a Lorentz transformation gives rise to total derivatives. Now, we were discussing that in the last class we talked about how if we looked at the Lagrangian for a spin particle, we could pin it down entirely by the demands of Lorentz invariants. Now, there was a question saying, what if the Lagrangian itself was not Lorentz invariant, but only the action was? And I was I gave the argument that all such additional possibilities are trivial in this particular case. Okay. Excellent. So let's recall what we were talking about last class. Last class we approached the study of general relativity from two different streams. The first one was the slight discomfort with the theory of special relativity. The theory of special relativity, or the framework of special relativity, is this nice framework in which different inertial observers are equivalent. Namely, the laws of physics take the same functional form when expressed in terms of the variables of any inertial observer. However, this nice democracy between inertial observers is broken when you move to non-inertial. So this is like ancient Greece. They had a perfect democracy between the citizens. Most of the people there were slaves. So that seems somehow unaesthetic, and it leads to the kind of questions being asked a lot in the early days of general of special relativity. Who decides which observer is inertial? Okay, so this led us to asking the following question: can we try to write laws of physics in a manner that is completely democratic among different observers? All coordinate systems described in physics give you the same laws in the sense of the same functional form of the equations of motion. Okay. Now, in order to try to implement this philosophy, what we did was we wrote down the Lagrangian for a particle, a free particle moving special relativity. We motivated this Lagrangian. There were lots of questions about it. But now we all believe that the Lagrangian x mu dot, eta mu nu d lambda, where x mu dot was equal to dx mu by d lambda, and lambda was an arbitrary parameter. This action is reparametrization invariant. If you change lambda to some function of lambda, you get this action. Okay, this was correct in an inertial difference. And we said, well, let's try to implement our program for extension of democracy. So we moved to non-inertial frame of reference. Okay. So we went like we moved to new coordinates y mu's such that x mu's were x mu was some arbitrary x mu of y mu. And we found that the action took the form y mu dot g mu nu d lambda by g mu nu was equal to d x mu alpha beta eta alpha beta by d y mu d y mu. Okay. Now this looks like a very beautiful action. This is correct in any coordinate system. by this quartet transformation of the metric eta, who's not the most general metric one could write up. By metric, I mean symmetric tensor as a function of four variables. We know that that was not the most general metric we could write down because the most general metric is 10 different functions of four variables. And this kind, these kind of metrics are obtained from a particular form with four arbitrary functions. So clearly, it's not the most general metric. Okay. Now, this way of writing this Lagrangian may look more democratic, but it isn't actually, because the Noetherian observers are still special. And they are the observers in which the metric is ignored. We haven't changed any physically, just a rewriting that doesn't bias anything. However, this way of thinking suggests the following possibility. Suppose that in the real world, this metric G mu nu was really allowed to be an arbitrary function. Suppose that was the case. Then, in particular, there would be no coordinate system in which the metric was eta mu. So there would be no special inertial observers. All observers would then be on the same footing. Okay? We would have, furthered this principle of democracy that is inherent in the principle of relativity. So, we came up with this wild idea. It wasn't us, it was Einstein. Shame. But okay. We came up with this wild idea, which was that this Lagrangian, for an arbitrary G mu nu, describes the correct equations of motion in some physical situations. Now, some G mu nus could be coordinate transformed to eta mu. That just gives us free motion in the right coordinates. That's boring in order. But suppose we looked at G mu nus that were like eta mu nu plus small fluctuations. That could not be transformed to eta mu nu, but were eta mu nu plus small. Then there should be small fluctuations about free motion in the Lorentz invariant space. Now, we know about small deviations from free motion in the Lorentz invariant space. We describe this by saying a particle is subject to a force. Okay, so at least for small fluctuations around the Lorentz invariant space, if this crazy idea that this could actually describe the laws of physics in some situations correct, then it must be that the effect of turning on an arbitrary metric field mimics the action of some force of nature. Then the next thing we asked was, what force of nature could it be? Well, on very general grounds, we immediately came to the following conclusion. We came to the conclusion that since, then we quoted an algebraic fact, which I didn't prove in the last class, but we will this week. It is possible even though it's not possible to set an arbitrary metric to eta mu nu by coordinate transform all over space, at any given point it's possible to set g to eta and g dot to zero. Okay, so having g non-zero in all of space leads to some effective force, this force has to have a very special kind of property. It has to have the property that this force, wherever it is of the form that allows you to move to a particular reference frame in a very small infinitesimal neighborhood of an event, in which you see no forces, because g is eta, and g dot is zero. And g dot is zero will be important. That's what I'm saying. Okay, now, you might think, well, whenever I've got a particle exhibiting a force, I can just move along with that particle that I see no force. What's the big deal? But the point is that this should happen simultaneously for all forces. For all particles. If you have 20 particles in your infinitesimal neighborhood, we should be able to move to a frame of reference in which the force due to this force field, then we think coupling due to the metric, vanishes for all of them together. Now that's not true of electromagnetism. Because we've got an electron and a positron, we've got an electric field, the electron field is forced this way, the positron field is forced this way, you get to the frame of reference where the electron field is no force, you'll see the positron accelerate. So this idea could be described in electromagnetism. Okay? So if it describes a force, it must describe a force that can be gauged away by moving to the right frame of reference. In an infinitesimal neighbor, for all particles then. Is there such a force of nature? Lo and behold, there is. It's a force of gravity. It's a famous fact that the equations of motion of a particle subject to the gravitational force are independent of its mass. And therefore are the same for all bodies. Okay? So the gravitational force has this basic character that lends itself to a description by this maneuver. No other force of nature that we're aware of has this feature. So if this maneuver describes some force of nature, it must be the gravitational force. It's no other candidate. Far from clear from these words that it does describe the gravitational force. But that, of course, is the purpose of this course. Yes?
See, in what 20 particles and 20
of you have that assumption between no force for all the 20 particles. Due to the gravitational force, yes.
Small region you're going to encounter no force, and then you're going to continuously move to regions where you no force.
We're making this experiment at one over a little time, over a little region of space. We're looking at the system over a little time and a little region of space. We look at that system in a particular coordinate system. The coordinate system that says g to eta, g dot to zeta. In that coordinate system, we know that for a little bit. You see no force. Okay? But you see no force for everything that's in your region. Not just for one particle, but for all of them. That is not possible with any dynamics. But it is true of that.
But suppose if you bring in another degree of freedom, let's say positively charged neutral or negatively charged, then can we formulate?
Yes. So this would take positively charged and neutral, for instance. This would be as big a contradiction. You go into the frame of reference of neutral guy, it's not accelerating, but the positively charged guy is. Okay? Just to clarify, I'm not saying that this principle disallows the force of electromagnetism. Of course not. I'm only saying that this maneuver, that is, coupling the particle to the metric, that itself gives rise to an effective force. That effective force has this property. If you change the Lagrangian in other ways, for instance, by the way, you could add to this Lagrangian this is coupling into an electromagnetic field with potential in you. And that cannot be gauged away by going to the right coordinate system. Okay? So I'm not saying that this is the only possible force in special relativity. Far from it. I'm just saying that the force that you obtain by replacing eta with g, that is an effective force when g is near eta. That force has this property. And there is a force in nature that has this property. It's the force of gravity. This property was remarked on by, from the beginning of the modern study of physics, by Galileo, for instance. It's a striking property of gravitation. And once you have this idea, it's natural to think perhaps this is the reason behind this striking property. Okay, this striking property that all particles accelerate the same way under gravity, or that you can move to a frame of reference where gravity, force of gravity is gauged away, it's called the principle of equivalence. Okay, so such a maneuver implements the principle of equivalence. Okay? So perhaps it is the correct maneuver for the study of gravity. Okay. Now, so this was our motivation for trying to study such a theory. And I said that we will come back to the study of particle motion in the presence of a general metric.
In special relativity, most general coordinate transformation we consider Lorentz invariant, Lorentz transformations. In general relativity, that would be equivalent to all lithium
ions. That's right. Wait.
Corresponds to the choice of an observer is the choice of the coordinates.
That's right. Even saying an observer is a bit, a way of measuring things. Yes. Right. Good. So, then the next thing we did was to say, if we're going to try to make a theory whose fundamental motivation is the idea that we should be able to describe things by the same equations of motion in every coordinate system, we'd better learn how to transform between coordinate systems. Okay, and we did some mathematics, which I'll briefly remind you of, but just continue.
Can we have a comment about that? Is it what you can see here? Identify with the
with the what?
Tetrams and
fire beams. With the tetrams and fire beams. You know, we don't have any fermions here. So at the moment, the metric is not even dynamical. So whether you write the metric as a function or whether you write it as dot product of tetrads, it makes no difference. Okay? It's only when the metric becomes a dynamical field that we need to worry about whether the equations for the tetrads. We're not taking equations of motion with respect to geometries. Geometries some fixed factor. Okay? So as long as you get some geometry function, it doesn't matter how. It doesn't matter whether you get it by EA, or some other way. You put in that function, you get it. You've got it. Okay? At the moment, we're not allowed to ask this question. It's only when things become dynamical that we can. Yes?
How do you construct a system? Means you choose a particular framework for the system.
How do you choose coordinates, Yashki?
Like, how do you perform a measurement in a particular coordinate?
How do you perform a measurement in a particular coordinate system? Well, you know, you make some convention for labeling points of space-time. It doesn't matter what this convention is. With this convention, you will have equations of motion that will tell you how everything evolves in your dimension. If somebody has some other convention, there are formulas to transform between your results and this. So if you want to ask questions about where something happens, that is by itself not a meaningful question. But the relationship between two events is meaningful. And if you think about it, that's what physics is about. Does this particle hit this detector? You know, this detector somewhere, this particle somewhere, when they coincide, is an absolutely, you know, absolutely all observers will agree on that. Okay? Hold back on your question till we start doing calculations. You know, till we start actually trying answers to any physical question that fall through carefully enough, so we done. It doesn't matter about how you set up your coordinate system. Am I addressing what you asked? If you're asking what I think you're asking, it's a very good question. It's a question everyone who first studies general energy thinks very uncomfortable about. Hold back a little bit till we start addressing specific questions. Then you will see. Okay, good. Other questions, comments? Okay. So, we started doing some of the mathematics of general relativity, of quadrant transformations. So, we had a manifold. Somebody asked me to say what a manifold is. A manifold, as far as we're concerned, is any space, some object which is made up of a bunch of points, such that in order to label where you are, you need to specify four numbers. Okay, that's a four dimension. So an example of a two-dimensional manifold is this blackboard. To specify where I am on the blackboard, and to specify two numbers. Let's say the x-coordinate and the y-coordinate. You may choose some different grid on the blackboard, but however you do it, to specify where you are on the blackboard, you have to specify two numbers. Okay? Any space in which you need to specify d numbers to specify where you are on the space, for us is a manifold. This is not sufficient for a mathematician. He has certain smoothness requirements. But we won't get into that. Except if we need it. This is sufficient for our intuitive progress. Okay, so when I use manifold, I just mean switch time. Yeah. And in order to specify a way you are, you need to specify form. That's all. You don't need it. Okay, excellent. So we had a manifold here, and we had some coordinates x, and the new set of coordinates x was a function of the grid. And then we had two friends who were trying to describe the same objects on the manifold. So we started with scalar function phi, which was a function of x. And the other guy just tried to describe that as a function of y. And the transformation rule for this was that phi tilde of y was phi of x. And then we looked at derivatives of scalar. Okay? We looked at del mu of x, or del mu phi. your friend had his derivative of his scalar field, and we found that d by d, so let's explicit d by d x mu of phi, d by d y alpha phi tilde was equal to del x theta by del y alpha del by del y theta, sorry, x theta theta of phi of x y. And then we gave this guy a name, we called it A mu. So the transformation rule became A mu tilde of y was equal to del y, del x alpha by del y mu into A alpha of x of y. Okay? We had similar rules for upper indices, for vectors. Remember, we talked about vectors being little displacements on our manifold, and we described how they were transformed between observers. The rule was that A mu tilde is equal to del y mu by del x alpha A alpha of x. Okay. Note that in order to get the transformation rules for objects with indices down, we needed only to know x as a function. In order to get transformation rules for objects with indices up, we need to know both x as a function of y and y as a function of x. So this rule works even if the map is not inverted. This rule requires the map to be inverted. Okay, so projection, let's hear out. If you've got a submanifold, y described coordinates on a submanifold, you can take objects with indices down and pull them down to the y coordinates. But objects with indices up, that doesn't work. Okay? Then we talked about tensors with arbitrary index structure. An arbitrary tensor had mu1 to μn, mu1 and μk. And we gave the transformation rule of this tensor. It was very simple. Basically, the transformation rule went index by index. This index transformed according to this law. This index transformed according to the same law. So there's one factor for every index up, one factor for every index down, and then the final answer was a function of x. We wrote that down last class. Okay. Right at the end of the last class, we talked about invariant tensors. Okay. So we talked about delta mu nu, this object, which is one of indices A equal to zero otherwise. We showed that it was an invariant tensor, meaning that if you take delta and find delta twiddle according to this rule, its value is also delta. Okay? There's one more invariant tensor that will be of extensive use to us, so let's talk about it. And that is square root g times epsilon mu 1 to mu t. Okay, let's say it in four dimensions. So mu 1 to mu 4. So now let me define things. Firstly, what is epsilon mu 1 to mu 4? Epsilon mu 1 to mu 4 is the symbol. Okay, so we're in a four dimensional space. So firstly, it's an object with four indices, all of which are down. Now, by definition, we will say that epsilon 0, 1, 2, 3 is equal to 1. And that epsilon is otherwise completely antisymmetric. Okay? So, you make transpositions of indices in order to get to the form 0, 1, 2, 3. The number of transpositions you have to make tell you whether that epsilon symbol is plus 1 or minus 1. Okay, so it's a familiar thing, you've encountered it before. Epsilon with any two indices equal is 0. Okay, so I'm going to now look at how this object here transforms under coordinate transformations. Okay, so under coordinate transformations, so suppose I've got this as my index. This is my index in the x coordinate. This is my tensor in the x coordinate. I'm now going to ask, what is my tensor in the y coordinate? How do I address that question? Well, I just use my rules. The rules are, I take square root g, which is square root of the mean. Oh, and what's square root g? I should mention. What is square root minus g? I should have said that. The metric, you remember we talked about, was a matrix. As a matrix, you can take its determinant. Okay? So take g through this cause will be referred to as g. The determinant of a metric tensor will be referred to as g. Okay? The determinant of the inverse metric is 1 g. Because an in metric, because determinants have the product, the property that if determinant of A times B, determinant A times determinant B, but determinant of metric times metric inverse is identity, therefore determinant of metric times determinant of metric inverse is 1, therefore determinant of metric inverse is 1 over determinant of G. Okay? And I'm talking about determinant of square root minus G, because as we saw last class, a metric has negative determinant. We don't want to deal with imaginary objects, so square root minus. Okay. Now, so now I've got this tensor in my x-coordinate frame, and I want to find what it becomes when I apply my rules of coordinate transformations. So what does it become? Well, let's just apply it. We get minus square root g, which is the metric in the x-coordinate frame, times del x alpha 1 by del... Okay, so let's give this whole thing a name. Let's call it a mu 1 transform. So let me say it better. So then A tilde mu 1 to mu 4. What it transforms to in the new frame? Okay. Is equal to, well, is equal to what? Is equal to del x alpha 1 by del y mu 1, del x alpha 2 by del y mu 2, del, okay, let's write them all, del x alpha 3 by del y mu 3, del x alpha 4 by del y mu 4. Okay? Times whatever we originally had. Okay? So times what we originally had, which was A, but that was just square root of minus g, times epsilon alpha 1 to alpha. Now this is the x frame metric evaluated at the point x of y. Okay, so this so far looks like a pretty unnatural object. But now look at this product. Can anyone recognize this product? It's the determinant of the Jacobian, or more precisely, this object. Is equal to, by the rules of determinants, so A tilde mu 1 to mu 4 is equal to J, the determinant of J of x by y. I'll tell you what I mean by that in a moment. Square root minus G epsilon mu 1 to mu 4. Where I've used the rule that for any matrix, epsilon alpha 1 to alpha 4, m alpha 1 mu 1, m alpha 2 mu 2, m alpha 3 mu 3, m alpha 4 mu 4, is equal to epsilon mu 1 to mu 4 times determinant of. Okay, so I use this rule from the mathematics of determinants, which you're all either familiar with or you can refresh with when you get a chance, to apply it to the matrix, where the matrix, the alpha beta elements of the matrix are del x alpha by del y beta. Okay, so that matrix, the matrix whose alpha beta elements are del x alpha by del y beta, has a name, It's called the, I don't know if this, maybe it's the determinant that's called the Jacobian. Anyway, we'll call it the Jacobian. Here we call it the Jacobian matrix. Okay? And I'm denoting that matrix by J, X, by Y. To say it's the Jacobian with X in the numerator and Y in the denominator. Okay? So now we've got this rule. This still looks a little weird. We put this J, X, by Y, and we put square root minus G in the X quadrant. But this product is nice. Why is this product nice? Oh, I should cardinal symbol. Why is the product nice? Let's remember what G tilde was in terms of G. Okay, G tilde of alpha beta. Okay, was equal to del x mu 1 by del x mu by del y alpha, del x nu by del y beta, g mu nu. And I'm not repeatedly writing the arguments inside, just because formulas become big to write. If anyone's confused at any point in the way you're evaluating things, ask. This involves the same matrix, del x by del y. Okay, now let's write this in matrix language. Suppose I think of G as a matrix. Okay, then this becomes the equivalent. G tilde is equal to J, G, J transpose. Okay. Which tells you that determinant of G tilde, using this rule for determinants, products of determinants that we talked about, is equal to det J times det G times det J transpose. Now, does anyone know what det J transpose is? Det J transpose is det J. Yes. So this is det J squared. Okay. So square root of minus G tilde is equal to det J times square root of minus G. And in taking the square root, I use the positive sign because I assume that my coordinate transformation is one to one. Do I have to assume both? 1-to-1 guarantees that it's a definite sign, is it? Well, it doesn't guarantee that it's determinant is positive. Okay. Yeah, so strictly speaking, right, exactly. So this object is, well,
it should be a reinforcement.
Exactly. This object is invariant only under coordinate transformations that respect this orientation. Otherwise, it picks up a minus sign. This is the fact that epsilon is parity, not parity. Okay, so let's restrict for 2 minutes to coordinate transformations for which det J is positive. Okay, there's a discrete ambiguity. I mean, there's two possible signs. If we assume that it's positive, then this times square root of minus G is square root of minus G tilde. And therefore, A tilde is equal to square root of minus G tilde times epsilon. And therefore, the formula for A tilde is the same formula in terms of tilde variables as the formula for A. This was our definition of an invariant tensor. So, square root G times epsilon is an invariant tensor. Now, what is the point of having invariant tensors? The point of having invariant tensors is that it's very easy to make coordinate invariant objects using invariant tensors. See, if you take an arbitrary 4 tensor and multiply it by an arbitrary product of 4 vectors, contract indices, that object is not coordinate invariant. Because when you transform the four vectors, that induces a transformation on this tensor, and this tensor in general rotates. But if the tensor has the property that is, the rotated tensor is the same as the original tensor, just by moving to the new coordinate system, then that whole expression is invariant under Lorentz transformations. Okay? So, invariant tensors are important objects to help us to build Lorentz invariants, or in not Lorentz, coordinate invariant, general coordinate invariant objects. Okay? And will be used extensively through this course. Okay, so these two invariant tensors that we encounter, namely delta mu mu and epsilon mu 1, mu 2, mu 3, mu 4, will be very useful for us through this course. Any questions or comments? Okay, the last thing I wanted to say about this invariant stuff, or we're going a little slow. Sorry. The last thing I wanted to say was about an integration. We will often need to take something and integrate it over all of space-time. So suppose I take d4x, and I want to see what this becomes in terms of d4y. Well, we all know what it becomes, right? So this d4x is equal to d4y times Jacobian of x, y, y. This same determinant. I'm not sure whether Jacobian refers to the determinant. We'll talk about this in the future. Let's read off. So this integration measure, d4x, is not coordinate invariant. This is obvious. D4x is a measure, you know, that encloses the volume with giving unit volume to unit length in, or for a unit cube in x. And something that has a unit cube measured in x clearly does not have unit size if measured in 5 times x. So it's obvious that this is not an invariant integration measure. Now, since we're going to need to integrate things over all of space-time, there's an immediate question. Can we find a coordinate invariant integration measure? And the answer is obvious. Staring at the same algebra. Okay? The answer is that integral g d4x is a coordinate, but minus g. Integral minus g d4x is a coordinate invariant. Why is that? Because we've just seen that under coordinate transformations, this goes to, under coordinate transformation, this goes to minus g tilde times, let's do it the other way around, since that's what we've seen. Let's check what integral minus g d4y is. Okay, this guy we've just seen goes to j times minus square root of g. So it goes to square root of minus g times det j of x by y. And this thing transforms to det j of y by x. But this is the determinant of a matrix. This is the determinant of its inverse. So the product is assumed to determine this one. Okay, once again, there's some modulus business going on. We're assuming that the signs.
So here it won't matter.
Depends on whether you take d4x. Right.
So there's a modulus.
Okay, good. If you do that, if you say that, right, good, you're right. If you think of just an unsigned volume, such as d4y, then you put a modulus. So Prahar's point was that this is this with this modulus. And this formula really comes out with this modulus. We choose a branch of the square. So then this will just cancel. I agree. Yeah, it won't matter. With a particular rule for transformation of square root of a determinant. Because you have to choose a sign by taking the square root. You choose the right sign so that it's always positive, then it doesn't matter. Good. Thank you. Okay. So this is an invariant integration. This is an invariant integration measure and will be used to to generate coordinate invariant integrals. Okay. This is all I want to say about basic manipulations with coordinate changes. We're not going to talk about coordinate invariant differentiation. But any questions or comments? Okay. Is this, if I'm going too fast, you should end. Okay? We have the advantage of having a beautiful book in the form of this course. As usual, the books by Landau and Lipschitz are the best books on this subject, despite being 50 years old. It's just quite incredible. Okay, it's a beautiful book. Everything's crystal clear. Yeah, go and read it. Or ask me to slow down. Or ask me questions. Okay, great. So now let's move on. So we've discussed some basic manipulations of coordinate transformations. But now we want to understand how to take derivatives in a coordinate invariant domain. So what is the issue? So suppose I have, for instance, this object. You know, a one form, an object with one index now. And I want to study its derivative. So I want to study del by del x alpha of t. The question I'm asking is, how does this object transform under coordinate transformation? Does it transform in some nice way? Let's just compute it. Okay? So what do we want to do? What we want to do is to compute del by del y alpha, let's say, of A tilde mu. Okay? And see how that's related to del by del x alpha of A. But this is not something for which we can independently specify a transformation, since we already know how A tilde mu transforms. So we can compute how it transforms. Okay? So what is this? So this is equal to del by del y alpha of dx alpha x theta by dy mu of A of theta. Okay? Now, in this object there are two terms. This derivative could act on this object, or it could act on the A. Let's first look at the action, the term that you get by taking the derivative and acting on the A. So that gives del x theta by del y mu into del by del y alpha of A theta, but there I can use the chain rule. So del by del y alpha of x theta, times del by del x beta of A theta. Okay? And this term is, so now this term is the same object, this object in the old x coordinate system. These two terms are exactly what you would expect to transform this object were it a tensor with two lower indices. Okay? So when you take the derivative and act it on A theta, you get exactly the transformation. This, that part of it gives you the transformation properties that you would expect were this object to be a tensor. That's then. So I've taken del by del alpha of A theta, del by del y alpha of A theta. But I use the chain rule to convert the del by del y alpha into del by del y alpha of x beta into del by del x beta. Coming. Okay. Plus, so we get the second term, which is del 2 x beta by del y alpha del y mu. Okay. This transformation rule tells you that this object is not a tensor. because it does not transform according to the rules of tense. Okay? In particular, the transformation rules are homogeneous. Derivatives of y do not depend. Y derivatives of mu do not, in x coordinate system, do not depend linearly on y derivatives of mu in the y coordinate system. There's also a piece that depends just on a rather than the derivatives. Okay. So this object wasn't a tensor. This sounds like this is something pretty bad. It's something pretty bad because, you know, all the Lagrangians in physics are full of derivatives. Maxwell's equations. Any reasonable Lagrangian will have derivatives. And if derivatives transform so badly under coordinate transformations, it will seem like a miracle if we can make a coordinate invariant action. Yes?
Can it be said of the same thing as two derivative operator on a scale?
Yes, it's the same manipulation. Because we've seen how one derivative transforms. It's the same. Identity. Okay, good. So, it looks like, either a theory based on coordinate transformation, coordinate invariance involving derivatives are either going to be very messy, or we need a better way to think of these things. Of course, there are better ways to think of these things. And that's what I'm going to explain to you. Okay. I'm going to first start by doing a bit of a hack talk. And we'll slowly understand what the elements of this hack talk. What I'm going to say is that, look, I don't like this, so I'm going to try to invent. Okay, firstly we ask, physically what's going on? Why was it that we differentiated something that looked nice and got something that looks basic? And the point is that any tensor like this ABU as a transformation law that depends on del x by del y at the point at which you are interested in looking at the object. But a derivative doesn't involve looking at something at one point. A derivative is measuring something at one point, subtracting from that thing the same thing at another point. Okay? Whereas this first guy transforms according to the rules of a tensor at this point. This second guy transforms according to the rules of a tensor at the second point. So they're different, transforms nicely, doesn't transform nicely under either rule. It's an unnatural thing from the point of view of tensor and algebra to subtract vectors at different points. But unfortunately, that's what a derivative is. It involves subtraction of vectors of one form and anything that transforms at two different points. That's the reason we're landing up with this mess. Okay, now, you know, this kind of thing we encounter just by the study of coordinate systems in two dimensions. So suppose we've got a two-dimensional plane, we've got x and y. Okay, we've got a vector field in this two-dimensional plane. Ax is a function of x and y, ay is a function of x and y. Differentiating the components of Ax and Ay is straightforward. And this gives us a notion of the derivative of vector field in the xy coordinate system. We get the x component, we differentiate it component by component, multiplied by the unit vectors, vector field. Okay. However, suppose you use a less well-suited coordinate, you know, less good coordinate system. Suppose you used polar coordinates. So you wrote A was equal to R hat times AR plus theta hat times A theta. You try to differentiate this vector field and you just differentiate these components, AR and A theta, you get the wrong answer for differentiating the vector field. Because you also have to differentiate these unit vectors. We were lucky in the first case that we were using constant unit vectors. Okay? And that's basically another way of saying what the problem is. If we're working, we're just differentiating the components, we're differentiating the coefficients, but not the unit vectors. So let's think a little bit more, you know. Suppose we've got... Now, of course, everything's very easy when we're in flat space. So we have some notion of what constant vectors are. Then we can always move to that coordinate system, do the differentiation, there's no confusion. But we're in general relativity now, where there's no flat space. All coordinate systems are equivalent. Okay? Now what do we do? Okay. So we appeal to the following notion. Say, look, see. Suppose we've got some vector field here and some vector field here. What we really want to do, you have a little vector here and a little vector here, parts of a vector field. What we want to do is to move this object to this point so that its transport is parallel. Okay? You want to move this vector parallelly to this point. Then do the subtraction. That would be the correct answer for the derivative vector. This notion of parallelity, of course, in flat space is very clear. Parallel means having the same x component, same y component. Okay? What we're going to try to do now is to try to achieve the same thing. That is, try to achieve the process of parallel transport of vectors along infinitesimal lines in an arbitrary manner. First by introducing new objects, and then by putting physical principles on these new objects to determine. Okay? So, in this case, does anyone know what this parallel transport would be? Suppose I've got a vector, which has some ar and a theta, and I wanted to move it in the r direction. What would parallel transport amount to doing? Nothing. Something in the r and theta direction. You move it along the r direction, it remains in the same r, same theta direction. But if you move it in the theta direction, what will it amount to be doing?
Subtracting
an infinitesimal rotation. Okay? A rotation is linear in the original vector. An infinitesimal rotation is linear in the original vector. So this process of parallel transport, in simple examples, okay, is the following. If you want to parallelly transport some vector field A mu, okay, I'm going to do it first with one form. Okay, with one form field A mu, from x to x plus delta x. Well, let me do it right. From x to x plus delta x, then what? Okay. Then I'm going to assume that A mu parallel transform is equal to A mu, because we're doing infinitesimals. So, leading term, of course, okay? That's a small correction, but that small correction is itself linearly. Just like it was in small rotation. Okay? Plus, gamma mu alpha theta A. Times delta. Okay? So this is the parallel transform. This is the result. I'm going to assume that my spacetime is embedded with some object. It's a three-index object. I call it gamma. It's called a Christoffel symbol. Okay? So that, and this object tells us what the correct notion of parallel transport is. How to move a vector from x to x plus delta x. And this gamma is a function of x. Okay? Somehow, from somewhere, someone has given us a notion of what the correct rules for parallelly transporting vectors are. Now, we won't rely on someone giving us a notion for very long. We'll determine this notion. But that will take 20 minutes. So for now, just somehow there's some notion of parallel transport. Okay? And the rule is that under parallel transport, transform, A mu from x to x plus delta x, A mu goes to x. This is my rule. Okay? I'll sometimes write this as delta A mu is equal to, so the change. Gamma mu alpha theta A theta delta x. abstract method, you know. I'm going to try to use this postulate to try to see how, what I can say about other things. So the next thing I'm going to ask is, suppose somebody has given me this gamma 3 index symbol, how do vectors, that is objects with an index upstairs, transform and dependent transformation? That's very easy to see. Consider B mu tensor. This thing is a scalar. So how does it transform on a parallel transport? It doesn't, it's merit. So the transformation of this object on a parallel transform transport should be zero. But delta of this is equal to delta B mu A mu plus B mu delta A mu. From the rule for infinitesimals. Okay, so it's equal to delta B mu, which I don't know, times A mu, plus B mu, times delta A mu, which I do know. So gamma mu alpha theta A theta delta X mu, sorry, delta X alpha. This object has to vanish for any two vectors x and b. That's x and b and e. Now, there are a lot of dummy indices here. Everyone is comfortable with this convention of repeated indices being summed. I'm doing that all the time. Okay, so there are lots of dummy indices here. This dummy index, let me call it. What I want to do is to change the dummy index on the A sum here to be the same one as A. So I'll change this mu to a phi. So I'll just write it again. So this is so 0 is equal to delta B mu plus B, and let me call this phi gamma phi alpha, and let me call this mu. A mu delta X alpha. I've not changed anything, I've just changed a few dummy indices. But so what this tells you is that 0 is equal to delta B mu plus B phi gamma phi alpha mu delta X alpha into A mu. But then this object here is some vector that dotted with an arbitrary A mu is 0, which must mean that this is 0. Okay? Which tells us that delta B mu is equal to minus of B phi gamma phi alpha mu. A lower index transforms by this rule under parallel transport, then an upper index transforms by this rule under parallel transport. Okay. Now, it's okay. Yes, you were asking.
So, what is the rule behind between the change of this form?
Of this form? Well, firstly, it's infinitesimal, so it's, you know, it's A mu plus something. It's got to be proportional to delta X. The assumption we're making is that it's also proportional to 8. Why is that? That's because it's true for every... So you write down an arbitrary coordinate system in flat space and do parallel transport, and always amount to some effective rotation. So that's what we're doing. Locally, what we've got is some coordinate system that is not flat. And we want to move the vectors parallelly. So that amounts to moving the vector plus a rotation. Change of coordinate systems. And change of coordinate systems transforms A as linear. Okay? So that's the only assumption we're doing here, because we're not talking anything about what gamma is. No, there are no other assumptions. It should depend on three indices, but it has to, because it's linear, this has to be okay. Okay, so just writing down the most general thing gives you this. gamma is a function of x, so also can be written as a function of y, and we will determine what gamma is as we go along. At the moment, we don't know what it is. We are leading up to the process of determining. Okay. Now, the next thing we're going to say the next thing that we are interested in is to try to work out the rule for parallel transport of an arbitrary tensor field. Okay. So suppose we look at a tensor field that was being viewed two indices down. Now, one example of a tensor field with two indices down is a product of two one-forms with indices down. Moreover, any tensor field with two indices down can be written as a sum over two one-forms with indices down. So if we determine how two one-forms with indices down transform, we determine how a two-index object transforms. But that's not trivial, because so suppose we've got B1 mu and B2 mu nu. Delta of this, what is that? That is equal to, well, delta of B1 mu B2 mu plus B1 mu delta B2 mu, just because infinitesimals. Okay, and then we apply the formula then. The formula then, which tells us is equal to gamma of mu alpha theta B1 theta B2 nu plus gamma plus B1 mu gamma of nu theta alpha B2 theta delta. The whole thing times delta. Okay? So that tells you that for an arbitrary two-index object, delta of B mu nu is equal to operation on first index leaving second one unchanged plus operation on second index leaving first one unchanged. So gamma mu alpha theta B theta nu plus B mu gamma nu alpha theta theta delta delta x. Clear? Basically it just works index by index. Do it for the first index, leaving the second one unchanged, do it for the second index, leaving the first one. Similarly, when we've got a tensor with many lower indices, many upper indices. This gives us a rule for parallel transport of arbitrary tensors. Now, some of you are thinking, what is all this parallel transport nonsense? This parallel transport is quite an abstract concept. I'm interested in formulas. Okay, this is an attitude I sympathize with. All this blah, blah, blah bullshit should lead to formulas. Okay, what interesting formula, you know, not for some abstract notion of parallel transport, but for something interesting, does this lead to go by? There's a class here at 4 o'clock, so we're considering. Okay, 7 or 7. Yeah. Okay, so that's we'll be a good outline. Okay. So the thing that we're really interested in, of course, is not all this parallel transport business. What we're really interested in is derivatives. How do we use derivatives to define, how do we use parallel transport to help us define good derivatives, namely derivatives that will transform like vectors? So now let me try once again to do what we failed to do last time. Okay, I want to define the good version of d by dx alpha of a nu. Now what should I really be doing? This object here was equal to a nu of x plus okay, let me multiply this by delta x. Okay, x plus delta x minus a mu at x divided by okay, just a minute. So suppose I really was interested in dx.
Yeah.
D by dx. Okay, forget about this. So suppose I was interested in this, then this x, you know, just moving just the delta alpha x, only in the alpha direction and zero in the other directions. And divided by delta x alpha. I'm sorry for the composite notation, but I hope it's clear. I'm just defining a derivative. Okay, that's what this object was, and it didn't transform it. What is the object that should transform it? What should transform well is a at x plus dx parallel transformed to x. And then subtract. Then subtract. Alright? Okay. So, now the parallel transform from x to x plus dx involves a plus half. And therefore, from x plus dx to x involves a minus half. Okay? So, of course, this term, which was this derivative, will be there. But in addition, we will have minus... So, okay. So, this is a bad. But what we've said is that the good object we'd expect to be the following. Minus gamma mu alpha theta. This object now is the difference between A at x plus dx, parallel transform to x, minus A of x divided by delta x. Okay? So if we've got a good notion of parallel transform, now this should give us a good notion of a derivative. Because now in this derivative, we're only subtracting two vectors at the same space time point. Each of which transforms to a tensor, so the difference should transform. Okay, so this notion of parallel transport is a fancy set of words that actually tells you that what we're interested in is defining such a derivative. Okay, so if we have a good notion of parallel transformation, transport, we have a good notion of differentiation, and by good we mean this object must transform like a tensor. So, now that that the blah 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 has done its work, let's start going on to formulas. So, what we want is that this object transforms like a tensor. Let's process what that means. The minus sign is because in the derivative, okay, what we want is, so there are two options you have in defining this differentiation. What you must either do, let's take one of them. Let's take the vector field at x plus dx, transport it to x, and then subtract from that the vector field at x. Now the parallel transport from x plus dx to x has a minus sign, because the parallel transport from x to x plus dx has a plus sign. Now there's a second way of saying it. Suppose you want to say, look, we have democracy. We have 2 points. You transfer it from one to the other. I don't like that. I'll transfer from here to here. Free to do it. That's it. Let's take that. Then what we want to do is to take the field at x, parallel transport to x plus dx. That parallel transport involves plus sign. But then the result that you get has to be subtracted from the vector field at x plus dx. So that will give the minus. Either way will give you. Is this clear? Excellent. Fine. So now, what we're going to do is to take this object and deduce from it a rule of coordinate transformation for the symbol. So we've got this parallel transport symbol. Its role in life is to create tensors from differentiating tensors. So this object must create a tensor from differentiating a tensor. Let's see what would make that work. Okay, so what calculation do we have to do? Let's compute this in the tilde coordinate system. Let's compute it in the original coordinate system. And it, I mean, demand that the transformation rule is tensor-like. That will give us a transformation rule for gamma. Okay? So, let's go. We put that part of this calculation before, but we'll do it again. Okay? So, we have... First, let's compute this with tilde. So, that's d by dy alpha a tilde mu of minus, let's call that gamma tilde, theta mu alpha a tilde d. Now I apply the rule for transformation of a tilde. Okay, that's d by dy alpha of del x phi by del y mu a phi, they have to write the both terms, minus gamma tilde theta mu alpha a. Okay, but that's right. This out as well. So that's del x phi by del y theta a phi. Okay. That's what this object is. Okay? We'll simplify it a little more as we did a little time ago by looking at the two derivative terms. Okay. So there's one term which is del 2x phi by del y alpha del y mu a phi. And then there's a second term. This, of course, is going to be the problem term, the interest term. Okay. But let's look at the volume terms first. That's plus plus del x y by del y mu del x zeta by del y alpha del by del x zeta of a phi minus gamma tilde, which we still don't know, of theta mu alpha del x phi by del y zeta a phi. Okay, now what do we want? We want this whole thing to be this times the covariant derivative. The covariant derivative in x. This whole business, by the way, this combined derivative is called the covariant derivative. Okay? So we want this time, if the answer was this factor times covariant derivative of a, we would declare it to. Okay? But in the absence of this term, that would work exactly if gamma transformed like a tensor. Suppose gamma tilde had transformed like a tensor with this index structure, then we would get these two factors from these two terms, and this factor would cancel this factor. Okay? So in the absence of this term, gamma would just have to transform as a tensor. So, suppose now what we're going to do is to try to cancel this term. Oh. Just 1 second.
Yeah.
Okay, so suppose we take the rule that gamma tilde theta mu alpha is what it would have been a word of a tensor, namely del y theta by del x. We're running out of indices, right? Theta prime. Del x mu prime by del y mu del x alpha prime by del x alpha gamma theta prime mu prime alpha prime, and then whatever is needed to cancel this, which is plus sorry, D2 I want the net thing to be this thing, right? D2x theta by dy mu dy alpha times something that will cancel this to make it, you know. So del okay, this is zeta del y zeta, sorry, del y theta by del x zeta. Now this transformation rule will kill this term, make this transform like a tensor, and give us a covariant derivative transforming like a tensor. Okay, so we have denied that this fancy parallel transform object, whatever it is, has to obey this logic. Okay, that's it, people. Sorry, we have to run outside class.